Phoenix's turn to ban. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Dire team ban. Phoenix's turn to pick.
Shadow Fiend.
Dire team pick.
Juggernaut.
Dark Seer.
Phoenix's turn to pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Spirit Breaker.
Phoenix's turn to ban. Dire team ban. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Phoenix's turn to ban. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Welcome back, guys. Game number two here for you. I'm Dirk in the JD Studios, bringing you Dota Pit Season 4 by G2A. And game number one was a little bit one-sided there. MVP Phoenix kind of ran away with things. Our Trust were left struggling, but new game, new draft. Different heroes this time around. And my co-caster Scant for today, this game for this series. Trust start with a Juggernaut. They get that hero again, but this time they have the Darkseer. But my question for you is, who plays Shadow Fiend on MVP Phoenix?
Qo does. I'm pretty sure Qo does. It's a big Qo hero, and Spirit Break is also a big MVP hero, although again, we used to see March playing this hero all the time. He's not around anymore, so I don't know if they'll run it in a support role or offlane role. But Signature.Trust, I think the Darkseer pickup as much of a block pick as it is a pick, because you don't want to be against the Darkseer Spirit Break at the start. But they'll convert it into their own thing, picking the Winter Wyvern and having a combination of their own now.
This Curse Vacuum going to be pretty big for them. So Radiant Side Shadow Fiend for MVP here. Obviously easy access to the jungle. You've got medium camp to farm, large camp to stack. Spirit Breaker can, you know, cause a little bit of havoc on the mid lane as well. Give SF a bit of an easier time for the first couple of waves if it is in that support role. And we've seen a lot of people kind of deviate away from the offlane Spirit Breaker, mainly for sort of XP reasons. If you're an offlane Spirit Breaker, you want to be charging around looking for kills and openings, but at the same time, you want to be getting your levels and making sure that there's no wave pushing into tier 1, so you're always caught in this kind of, well, damned if I do, damned if I don't situation. And with the bounty hunter picked up there, okay, maybe it will be the offlane Spirit Breaker and he just focuses up on that top lane. But that bounty definitely adds into that credence I was saying before, that they want to secure their lanes. They want to make sure that Shadow Fiend has a good time. They want to make sure that Signature Trust are, you know, put on tilt a little bit early on, I feel.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with the Spirit Break and the Bounty Hunter both applying that pressure. It's also an offlane combo that really threatens weak supports often. Bounty Hunter scouts you, attacks you with an orb of Ben, and Spirit Breaker charges in. So I will say that Winter Wyvern is possibly the best support at dealing with this, actually. In fact, Winter Wyvern with a TP scroll is almost a hard counter to Spirit Breaker ganks, because, you know, you like charge someone, okay, they get Cold Embraced, and now Spirit Breaker can't do anything. That said, if you're charging this Shadow Fiend's lane, Cold Embrace is not going to save the person, because there's going to be the triple rays going straight through.
I'll trust difficult decision time. Tiny is going to be the pickup for them. Phoenix, so Tiny mid lane is going to be with the Darkseer off lane, Juggernaut up to top. So Tiny Wyvern is going to be like a dual lane mid for a little while. Maybe, yeah. I mean, an interesting showcase for my pro to actually beat that Shadow Fiend, especially once SF hits like level 4 or 5. It's not easy. Not easy at all. So I think Wyvern has to do a ton of stacking. This also means that the dire jungle is going to be very crowded, I feel. 10 seconds. Three heroes here that utilize the jungle pretty heavily.
And not just there's three heroes using the that really want the jungle. There's a bounty hunter on the enemy team, which is going to be very good at disrupting all three of them. So I think it's possibly problems. I mean, obviously, Signature Trust have a good start. They get some sentries up. They contain the bounty hunter. They should be okay. I mean, they'll still have to deal with who gets which farm. But if it's starting to look a bit like the previous game, where if MVP Phoenix get the start they want, things could snowball quite easily, because you're not going back to the jungle for farm against the Bounty Hunter and a Spirit Breaker. It's not going to be that easy.
Let's look at best case scenario here for Trust. They get a 15-minute mech arcanes or something on the Darkseer. They can go and fight with the Juggernaut. They pressure into towers. And MVP Phoenix at this point in time... Oh god, there it is. At this point in time, don't have any D push, right? They've got nothing to slow down pushes, stop team fights in their tracks, and just clear out creep waves. But with a gyro there, that's like the perfect pick. I think that's absolutely perfect for them, because it does all those things, ticks all the boxes. You can TP react early to pushes if things go badly in laning phase. You can call down to stop that tier 1 pressure. You've got a decent way of clearing creep waves. But it also adds even more power to your lane. That rocket barrage is very good. Just need someone to try and keep tabs on that Darkseer a little bit. But yeah, that's like best case scenario for Trust is that they get a good start on Darkseer. They push with the Juggernaut and Tiny gets the farm. Worst case scenario, Darkseer has to go into the jungle and farm, takes Tiny stacks. So Tiny is then, you know, the knock-on effect is Tiny is delayed by a further 5-10 minutes. Juggernaut, he has to really be the active key component here.
Did I lose you?
This game, I feel. Remaining.
5 seconds remaining.
It's a fifth ban out from Phoenix. Gonna be looking at. I guess five.
It's like I dropped from the Skype call for a second there, but I'm back.
Hi.
I wanted to say that it's nice to have Gyrocopter and Shadow Fiend as your two carries when you pick a bounty hunter, because it's kind of like infamous that the one weak point of a bounty hunter is that you maybe have a bit less damage output in your team, because it's mostly there for the tracks. It does some damage in a single target way, and sometimes when you track the whole team, the shuriken bounce can be great, but to have extra damage, you know, that much more damage coming out from your cores kind of compensates nicely for the fact that the bounty hunter is primarily there just to like give you information, give you track, give you move speed, etc.
Earthshaker would have been a good hero to stop Bounty and Spirit Breaker, yeah. But Trust? I don't know. You need heroes that are good against this roaming power. Maybe something to give you laning prowess. Because right now you've got big team fight combinations. You've got Curse, Vacuum, Tiny, Avalanche, Toss. Good pushing power into these tier 1s relatively early on if you get a good start. I don't know if you can run Darkseer in like a dual offlane. Actually, a lot of the heroes that you do that with have all gone. And yeah, there's just the all-rounder, the support that can maybe try and weasel his way into these cute little spots where he steals cooldown, if he steals track, something like that. But I feel Phoenix are in the much better spot, because their fifth pick here, it could literally be anything.
Yeah, Rubick is another support that's maybe good against Birdbreaker just in the sense that you can cancel the charge. But I don't know if you saw, Kura actually got asked about this in his interview at the Summit, why he's not playing Rubick that much. And he was like, oh, it's been nerfed in indirect ways, but he chose to use Birdbreaker as an example of Rubick's actually not that good against Birdbreaker anymore, because if you steal the charge, you only get the charge. It used to be that you could charge and bash them, but that's not based on the charge anymore, so it is like a slightly weaker steal for Rubick. Not that he's going to mind being able to steal, for example, Track or Rocket Barrage or Cooldown in this game, but very interesting to me if they're going to be on the Jakiro as the last pick for MVP Phoenix this game, because I don't know about you, but I don't think Jakiro really fits the kind of like run at you face roll playstyle that we expect to see from them. It's almost like, I don't know, is it like an insurance policy? I mean, I did feel like they needed some kind of lockdown.
Look at the two big damage dealers from Trust, Juggernaut and Tiny. What do they rely on the most? Attack speed,
five
right?
Seconds remaining.
Yeah, that's true.
Jakiro is going to be kiting these guys for days, I feel.
That is true. And if Jakiro can get gold enough to get a Yules, that will obviously be incredible, because then they got a secondary initiation. It's just not, I mean, it's a kind of slow, clumsy hero that doesn't, you know, hit time the way you expect Bounty and Spirit Breaker to. So I think the Jakiro player needs to be a bit more intelligent with, like, Febby has to be smart about how he moves, because if your movements are poor, it kind of has a knock-on effect of never being in the right place at the right time when the rest of your team is playing such a fast-paced game.
Well, Forev Spirit Breaker, Febby Jakiro, solo rank warrior, mental protector over on that gyrocopter, and Qo, the Shadow Fiend. Around, looks like he's heading towards mid lane. Ruby will be your roaming bounty. I'll Trust, Jab, Rubick, Micro, Mid, Tiny, Lakels again on the Juggernaut, Feimao this time playing the Winter Wyvern. So, what's their fifth hero? Darkseer. Darkseer, of course.
That's Darkseer, yeah.
They've got some good combos. It's going to be hard, though. I think also adding into this is that Jakiro is pretty good against the Darkseer. You throw out your Dual Breath, your Liquid Fire, and you make him burn through his regen very early on. So Darkseer is going to have a rough time. Can't really focus down that Gyro. You know, the first 3-4 minutes are good, but once Gyro gets phase boots, your lane becomes unwinnable. Absolutely unwinnable. Think the jungle. A lot of it is going to be down to this Darkseer farming that up. Winter Wyvern has to make a ton of stacks for Darkseer and Tiny, and then later on Juggernaut. I don't know if they're in the same situation again as the previous game where Juggernaut can go for phase drums. You know, I kind of liked it initially, but like you said, the kind of lead-up time to that Battle Fury was just far too long.
Yeah, it's going to depend in this game. I mean, if he wants to go phase drums, it'll probably be okay if Tiny has a fast blink and Darkseid has a fast mech and they just go fight straight up. But if they end up in a position where, like, they need him to get farmed to win the game, then again, it's going to be an issue. The one other thing about the Jakiro, I guess, is pushing towers, because it's a similar effect this game to the last game from MVP's draft. If they group up and go for a tower, it's going to die really, really easily because there's a Jakiro involved. The tower can't really protect itself. And that kind of has the impact of forcing Signature.Trust to take those early fights. Now, I'm not as clear this game on whether or not MVP are going to be just, you know, easily winning the early fights. But if they get themselves into a position where they're advantaged in the fights, they can just group up, go for towers, and, you know, you kind of have to defend your tower because it dies without doing anything. Normally, the tower itself plus the creep wave can, like, slow you down a bit, a wave or two, but when you're against the Jakiro, it doesn't really do that. It's like the first wave you get to the tower, you just stay there and kill it.
Oh, ready to get things back underway? Oh, Bounty Hunter, I kind of wonder where he's going to be heading. I think the dual lane mid kind of situation where Dubu can control top rune and give Qo a good time mid against Tiny should be where you aim to, but the Bounty Hunter doesn't match up very well against Winter Wyvern in that sort of harassed support role, and it looks like already, look at the sentries, observer wards, there's all sorts of bullshit to try and deal with the Bounty Hunter early on. So how many do we have? We've got two sets of sentries, that's four reveal wards actually, ready and waiting for. And it looks like they're actually going to go again for an aggressive dual lane with a Juggernaut, so Winter Wyvern jog down a bottom lane. It will be the Rubick that heads towards mid to help out Micro a little bit here. I guess Telekinesis does help with the lift back into toss, get the bounty behind the tier 1, and get some more damage down onto him. But Abba's Darkseer, maybe contested here by the Spirit Breaker. I guess that's what you're really looking for, is the Darkseer versus Spirit Breaker lane.
Yeah, this is, I mean, in the previous game, that aggressive dual lane with the Juggernauts, it's kind of like Team Secret style. Start with your one position in the off lane, start with your three position in the safe lane. It's especially good with the Juggernaut, which can actually be very effective in that off lane. But the problem in the previous game is actually the Slaughter that they put in the safe lane still didn't get a very fast blink. So I wonder, so exactly as you say, like if the Darkseer starts in the safe lane, but manages to get shut down, then it kind of undermines the whole purpose in laning the way that Signature Trust wants to.
Oh, they saw the bounty lift first. Telkens is there. Dupu's caught, and with the avalanche, it should be enough damage. The sentry is taken out. Dupu taking the Observer Ward as well, but he still drops. But I think that economic damage back onto the Dire is maybe not. They switch things back, and another sentry is placed. So it's an Ob and a sentry for an Obs and a sentry and a sentry. So that's worth it for the Dire then in the end.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think you want to go down first blood just to get a trade-off of getting rid of one sentry. Which is kind of what it works out to being. But we're going to see the usual start with 2v2 mid lane. Shakira is also actually a hero that's maybe quite reasonable in that position, although I guess the early cooldown Liquid Fire is not that great, so actually just throws one out and runs off to off lane. And this is, it seems like this is MVP's approach in general. They don't want to have the 2v2 mid lane. They want to have the 1v1 mid lane, and so they try and, like, you know, pressure you by going to the other lanes and saying, okay, you know, your support that's sitting in the mid lane needs to come somewhere else too.
QO is already off to a very good start. Two last hits, one deny. Creepwave is being dragged back here a little bit by both teams, so MyPro with his 68 base damage should be able to get a couple of hits in under the tier 1 tower. But yeah, aggressive dual lane. Juggernaut plus Rubick. Spiritbreaker is making his way down here for his charging to get into that lane, and the switch up has already occurred as MVP want this. You really want the gyro against the Darkseer. You do not want to be up against this aggressive dual lane because lift into spin, gyro is a fragile hero early on. 4 armor, sub 600 HP, he can definitely get taken down, especially when Lekels hits that level 2 Blade Fury.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's. It's just that, and they'll know it fresh in their minds for the previous game as well, obviously, the power of the Juggernauts in the aggressive lane to make those kills early on. So the plan's going to be to put the less important heroes against the Juggernauts. If he does manage to get kills, so be it. But also, those are the heroes that are more difficult to kill. Spiritbreaker is very tanky early on. Bounty Hunter will be able to go invis. Although the Bounty Hunter, I don't think it's going to actually join the duel. It's probably more likely to just be roaming around. Starting off by, I think, planning to make a stack here for the Shadow Fiend. So. Priority straight. This is QO Shadow Fiend, and this is kind of like in the past, the old MVP Phoenix, when they picked QO Shadow Fiend, usually their draft was like kind of all about him. It was make sure he gets his stacks, make sure he gets his early progression, and a bit like Miracle for OG, you can just kind of trust that once he has his farm, he will have the impact.
And he'll get the job done now. Sentry's down. Oh, Dubu, no. That's not how you do it. And he's in, not in trouble. No mana there for the Tiny to toss him or anything like that. So Bounty places a sentry, but there was one preemptively down from Feimao, and we'll take that out in short order. Like, Trust trying to bunker down on these lanes a little bit, but Abba up at top, this Darkseer, he's having a rough old time. Four last hits, level 2.5, and it isn't going to be that safe lane Darkseer that gets the super quick mech arcanes. He's going to get shut down a significant amount as he surges himself away, but Febby is waiting in the trees, ready for any speedy little movement from the Sonic Man. Now, MyPro, sitting on low HP here. You do have to be very wary of those raises coming out of QO. Dial himself back up to a good threshold of HP. But yeah, Abba at top. He's run out of mana. He has a Mango, he has a Sage's Mask. But at this stage, you really want your Soul Ring. Really, really, really want your Soul Ring.
And this is that thing, I mean, I talk about how in this meta, the game often gets decided by who wins the early fights. Who wins the early fights often gets decided by the offlaners. And Darkseer and previous game Slaughter, they're heroes that can win you fights, but they first need the farm. Whereas if you look at MVP's similar heroes, it's like Spiritbreaker. Like, it's going to set up the fight for you without the farm most of the time. So that's why I think it's an important pressure point. I guess in this case, Signature Trust also have the Tiny. If Tiny has a good start and gets an early blink or something like that, that's just as much setup to win the fights. But if they don't have the early items on the Tiny or the Darkseer, then when those fights start, it's going to be MVP favored, just as it was last game.
But look at what QO has been allowed to do here. 13 last hits. He's sitting up on top of the enemy ramp and just getting free clicks in there. And this Tiny can't really contest this. He's already used his bottle, sent it back, and it will return to him now. Both teams are going to be relying on the stacks over in the large camps of the jungle to actually bring their mid laners back up, like you're saying. Well, if Micro and QO about a farm in the next 5-6 minutes, then they can start turning things around. As QO does take a battering here, but his bottle's on the way as well. 3 minutes in, a little bit late there, but he did go for the Wraithband build. The rotation, though, from Jab, this is what we've got to look out for. He's pinging out to QO. Go for the kill, but Bounty spots him out, and QO should be able to get back behind the tower far enough. They still go for the telekinesis, but it's not going to be there. Micro not allowed to dive too far. That long-range raise did miss, and Zubu put himself into a rough spot, but I can't get the kill on Micro. That's what they wanted. SF kills Tiny. Yep, the that's Bounty Hunter's totally life fine. There is worth it.
Yeah, that's totally fine for MVP, and I was going to say, like, one positive sign for Signature Trust early on in this game is the Bounty Hunter is getting very little done, but actually, the way that they set up with the Shadow Fiend playing around QO, they're happy with that. So Bounty Hunter is making stacks, he scouted a gank, he's causing some trouble in terms of like warding, counter warding all the time. Yeah, sure, not really applying direct pressure to any heroes, but I think that that's okay for them if he's making QO's life easier.
And the fact of the matter is that Dark's here. Got his Sol Ring now coming out in the courier, I'm assuming. Yeah, that's good and good and fine for him. But Gyro is free farming. So the trade-off here is Gyro, Juggernaut are both free farming on these side lanes as well towards the mid. Micro. Look at the telekinesis back onto Dubu, but Jakiro is here with the dual breath, and they won't kill the Bounty Hunter with that liquid fire there. That's a lot of damage, and take a look at who's charging in. Spirit Breaker has his eyes onto this Micro Tiny, and with Hero's razors ready, they'll throw it out of the avalanche. Oh god, the pause. Okay.
What a time to pause.
That is the worst time to pause. So there's a toss here. QO. So QO is going to take, what, 150 minus the 25% damage. He's going to take like 110 damage or something, right? Thunder Blast is level 1. QO will probably die, but he should be able to get one raise out.
Well, there's a big decision for the Winter Wyvern. Are you going to call Embrace or not?
Oh, I think he goes Thunder Blast. Oh god, QO didn't even die. He will now though, but they still got the damage out, and Jab is going to get chased down with a double kill off the Jab. He got the Bounty Hunter and the Shadow Fiend. My goodness.
Before that whole fight started, actually, the Rubick and Winter Wyvern were making a smoke rotation, wanted to smoke down around into the enemy jungle, but the fight broke out and they just ran their smoke straight into the middle, which, I mean, it's obviously a minor cost, because early on you have quite a few smokes. It does tell you something about the fact that Signature Trust do feel pressure on themselves to get some things done, make some space early on.
Oh, Lakels does have a little bit of space down on this bottom lane. We've seen a fair amount, Loader and Big Daddy, No Tail. They've been going for a lot of kind of Phantom Lancer builds on Juggernaut, where you go Brand Boots, Drums, Aquila, Quelling Blade, and then into Boots of Travel. And it allows you to get into team fights a little bit faster, allows you to split push with the spin TP. And also, S4 said it, that the movement speed you get from BOTs just allows you to chase that much better, consistently, anyway, over the phase boosters. Lane Vacuum back, Abba gonna miss out on that one. Level 1 Vacuum not wide enough, but Lakels looks like he's going for the same old, phase boots. I wonder if he still considers going those drums though, because they did delay him quite a good amount.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough call for him. I actually, to be honest, I'm still a fan of the phase boots, at least on certain melee heroes, just because of that recent buff with the gap closing. Like, I think that people aren't used to it just yet, like how quickly you can burst, but there's an Invis SF heading here, and this is really trouble for Lakels.
He's got Omni Slash, but he chooses to get the spin out. I'll kill him off. They do a lot of damage back onto QO. Meantime, looks like Darkseer killed Gyro. Where was that? Up at top.
On his tower, on the Gyro's tower, so he must have dived him and then cleared.
Meanwhile, Jakiro dies at mid, just caught the tail end of that. So, Trust, that's a decent move for them. They lose Darkseer Juggernaut, but they do get some kind of trade-off. Best. But at least they're making something out of it, right? It's not just like, oh, we lost two heroes, we've got to go back to farming, we've got to sort of play passively. They're playing aggressively into these other lanes to try and poke and prod and find weaknesses.
Does Micro have a Quelling Blade just to help counter wards? I mean, do you need a Quelling Blade on Tiny to get last hits?
I have no idea.
I think it's got to be that they've had this like constant warding and counter warding battle in the lane. So, yeah, I don't know. Signature Trust doing all right in this game at the start. My concern is just that, again, I'll say it, that the lane stage does not dictate the game. And when we get into the first few actual like full-on team fights, what's gonna dictate Signature Trust success or failure is probably like if Darkseal Tiny have the early items. I think that MVP are gonna be a lot more item independent. Like, they want Shadow Fiend to have a big item before they have the first fight, whatever it is that he's gonna rush. But that's about it. That's like the only hero. Like, it's nice for Jara to have something, but Jara's contribution to the first fight is probably more the cooldown on Rocket Barrage.
Tiny still has a stack to take, actually, over in the Dire Jungle. I'm gonna assume it's him that takes it. You know, Darkseer is fine with his farm rate, Juggernaut's okay. Tiny just needs that burst of gold to get into his Blink Dagger a little bit sooner, so I think it's gonna be him. Yeah, look at Feimao already, just deboarding everywhere around this mid lane. He's got his brown boots. What we're looking at for Rubick, though, because I feel Rubick, even though it's not necessarily said a lot of the time, but Rubick is one of those farm-dependent supports that can rely on their skill set. He's got good skills, but actually utilizing them to their full capability, you need Blink, you need Force Staff, you need Glimmer Cape, you know, you need these mobility items, then into Aghanim Scepter to really give you that strength of teamfight presence. So Jab needs farm as well. I feel like there are four relatively greedy heroes here on Trust that they need another maybe 20 minutes to really hit their peak.
Well, the one advantage of the way the Bounty Hunter has been forced to play in this game is that he hasn't been able to go into the enemy jungle at all. So I don't think look at what they draw on the map. Hero saying, we need to go there and steal their stack. Because they haven't been able to like see the status of the stacks, where they are. They don't have that direct information. And they're not really in a position to do it just yet. So I wonder if they're going to back off from this bot side, they try to finish it first. Clearly drawn lines saying we need to steal those stacks, and I don't know about you, but I think if they manage to steal the stacks, that's huge trouble for Signature Trust.
Looks like the Kells is having a little bit of a PC issue. Blue screen. Lovely, lovely blue screen. Have you been watching the summit?
Yeah, I have been watching the summit.
Oh my god, did you see Moon Meander last night? Did you watch his cast?
Oh, you mean his casting?
Oh my goodness. The savage cast.
Yeah, he was pulling no punches.
That was the best thing I've seen in quite some time, actually.
I think that's part of the reason why the players all say that the summit is just like such an enjoyable event. I mean, there's lots of reasons, but I think that's one of them, that they get to like... I mean, you can see he's just enjoying himself, right? He's not... I don't think he's trying to, like... start any kind of rivalries or something. He's just, you know, he's just having a good time.
Yeah. Korok comment, the Ritsu flames, everything was pretty spot on, honestly. That guy, absolute genius. I mean, we had a little bit of fun with it as well on the Join.Dirt website. I don't know if you saw, but when he made that comment that OG was all American, and he gave the perfect argument that that Miracle was American because he lived in the Middle East. himself and Fly were both American because Israel is best buddies with NA and Notel because he's a flower. There's lots of Americans in flowers in America, and flowers are free. That's here is American. So we changed all their flags to the USA. So
yeah,
OG
I thought
now
it was
is a full USA team.
Yeah, I mean, and with that compelling reasoning, why not?
Exactly. His argument was flawless. Absolutely flawless. Yes.
The thing, while we're talking about the summit, by the way, that stood out the most to me is, I don't know if you watched how many of the matches you watched, like, at this, VG Gaming are actually looking really good. I mean, maybe it's obvious because they already beat OG and Virtus Pro, which are two strong teams, but there's something with Burning that wasn't working for them at the yes. Major. Like he wasn't happy with his heroes, or, like, there was... I don't know what it was exactly, but people were saying Burning's playing badly, and I think that's maybe a bit too oversimplified. But clearly, they weren't getting the most out of him. And now they are. Now they... You watch this, I mean, maybe it's like now they're picking like Carry Venge, they didn't exchange stuff, but the team looks happy, they're getting a lot out of all their players, and... I like honestly think VG Gaming have a good chance to beat EG tonight.
I mean, the one thing that made me... I was feeling the same thing, you know, he was very... It seemed he was very stubborn, but I don't know if it was him or the captain actually calling things out for him, with item builds and heroes especially, where... It was just outdated. He was, you know, using obsolete outdated item builds and things just weren't working. The one thing that changed my mindset on this was his Wraith King. The Wraith King with Midas Blink Desolator. This is just completely out of the norm. You know, you look at Wraith King, you think, right, standard build is treads, drums, Blink Blade Mail, Radiance, AC, BKB, things like that, you know, usually in that order. But going for a Desolator, that just shows that he is a very, very forward-thinking player. And I just wonder what was holding him back. You know, what was the factor that was sort of nagging him, saying, no, just go standard. Don't mess around with things. Don't change what's not broken. Instead of actually breaking the mold and showing that he's an amazing player. But anyway, we're back underway. 4 to 6, 7 minutes in. Trust against MVP here in game number 2 of this 2-game series in the Dota Pit Season 4 by G2A. And Signature.Trust have actually done pretty well in the laning phase. The Radiant don't get into the dire jungle to stop the stack being taken. Bounty Hunter's just a little bit too late for that as Jab walks himself straight past Bounty. But bot lane, Forev is about to hit level 6, and that's when we're going to start seeing them run around and really open up the map.
Yeah, so a good sign for Signature.Trust, they managed to farm their own stacks. Even so, Darkseer and Tiny are both very far still from their first major item, the mech or the flank or whatever it may be. And actually, Dubu's Bounty Hunter, despite having a kind of stand around, do nothing, be a mobile ward early game, almost level 6. And I do feel like Bounty Hunter hitting level 6 might be the time for MVP to stop making plays. Well, they're actually going to make a 3-man smoke with Bounty Hunter, Shadow 4.
Oh, God. I didn't catch that. I was watching the smoke as well. I was super worried Bounty Hunter didn't have any items, and then I realized he dropped his brand boots on the floor. Now, Courier is going to get scouted here. They're looking for someone else in the jungle, but QO should just be able to take down the Courier. Get a little bit of gold to line their pockets, and now Trust got the kill down on bottom lane on that Spirit Breaker, but my goodness, are you sure you want to stick around here? You know SF is in your jungle, you know Bounty Hunter's waiting around as well. Now QO just going to walk straight on into Flame Out. Went wide, but he's hit level 5, but with the cold in... Oh, missed raises. QO will still get the kill, but I don't understand that movement. Lack of movement. I don't understand why you stand still. You know there are three heroes top. You know they're coming into you. You have perfect vision. You'll stay on lane.
Yeah, I don't know. I can only suspect they thought because the stacks weren't there. SF will see there's no stacks and just leave or something like that.
He just killed the courier.
Yeah, he killed the courier. And you're thinking he was in our jungle looking for stacks. He didn't find stacks. Okay, he'll be scared and leave.
You got greedy. Omni Slash was to save you, not to look for kills. Now, oh, there's no cooldown actually. Darkseer jumps himself into the fight here with the charge forward. Abba, he's gonna get bashed up, and another Rocket Blast comes through. We'll be able to kill him off in a second time, and that's a nice juicy little kill for Jab. He's ready. He's taken Barrage, thrown it back into the face of the Gyro with a one raise out. Jab is not gonna die, but Febby and QO, they're looking for kills. They're looking for something. But this is a level 8 SF. There is no Requiem leveled up just yet. He's just given a good chunk of gold over to this Wyvern and Rubick. Okay, the Darkseer dies. He loses out on a fair amount. But that's level 7.5 on Wyvern. That's level 8 almost on this Rubick.
Jab is the third highest net worth in the game right now. he's 6-0 and 2 on Rubick. He could buy a Blink Dagger very soon if he wanted to. It's pretty phenomenal. I mean, he's not lost hits much. It's just like he's gotten all the kills.
QO. He wanted to punch Laquel, but it looks like he's going to get the one. Oh no, they turn back around! Femi there with the Ice Path, and now with the cooldown, they'll go straight back in. Requiem will slow them down. They do kill the Shadow Fiend with Jab. Managing to get the last click in there somehow with a Fate Bolt, I guess, but he does get the Rocket Barrage of the Febby and the Backpack. There's no wall. Abba, he's still level 8, but with Forev here, the Rocket Barrage turned back around. They'll take down the Spirit Breaker. Dubu, he's going to get these tracks out, but Solar Frank Warrior, Mental Protector, he's got nothing left to protect. Abba will get an Iron Shell back onto my prone with another toss. Should be able to find the kill? No? They give up on the Gyro and actually back themselves away.
Well, Dubu got, I think, 700 gold before getting the last hits on, which is on such a streak. 900?
890 gold.
Oh my goodness.
So that's a 400 gold swing to MVP. That's a decent amount of cash there, as the Gyro also gets his hands on about $400 there. But Shadowfiend dying once again. Still trying to build into that mech. He's getting there slowly but surely. The timing isn't awful to be fair. Like, we often look at 12 minutes as this key moment in time for mid laners, where Windranger gets Phase Boots plus Point Booster on top of Bottle Wand. Shadowfiend gets his Treads Aquila mech with the bottle. So he's not looking too bad, honestly.
All-man smoke, and Jab's got that new Blink Dagger on Rubick, so this is pretty scary if they run into someone. MVP could easily get burst on. Any hero, maybe even two heroes could get burst on, and it's gonna be the Solo Ranked Warrior.
Oh, he's gonna get Link Telekinesis up. Should be a simple kill. Gyrocopter is ripped apart there. 5 heroes from Trust down in this bottom lane, but you're right, Jab with the 12-minute blink dagger on a bloody Rubik, honestly. Who does that?
He's just barely the second highest net worth on his team. He was the highest until recently. And by the way, the kill you asked about in the mid when he killed Cure, I actually saw it was incredible, actually. I'm becoming a Jab fan. He knew that he couldn't get close enough to fade bolt the Shadow Fiend, so he just fade bolted the creeps and I kind of, okay, maybe it'll bounce to him. And it did, because the SF was trying to Requiem, so it's like pretty clutch play, I would say.
Well, Trust have the majority of their ults is up. There's still no wall, though, and they know the bounty hunter's coming in. They've got a sentry down on the low ground in the river. With the sentry placed out, bounty hunter will realize, hang on a second, they've got full vision of me. Give it over to the Shadow Fiend. Is he low on souls? No, he's up to 36, he's fine. But Signature.Trust, they have the advantage coming into this. Dubu, oh, did he see that? Did he see it coming in? They're pinging out. Yeah, they know it's coming. Telekinesis is up onto Q over the Witness Curse there as well. Lakel's trying to spin through, but with the heal, he's got the back. He's got himself back at the full HP. Dubu will get ripped apart, but it looks like Trust. All the ones coming out on top of this, even with the big old cooldown there. Vac wall was massive, but Shadow Fiend just not able to survive through the damage as Gyrocopter actually goes further into getting killed on Dark Seer, but will get taken out himself, turns the fight, Jab is dropping low, but MyPro still battling through it all, and Trust get themselves a full team wipe as he tosses the Juggernaut forward, and a double kill, mega kill streak for your Tiny. Blink, freshly purchased, back up to 1,000 gold.
So this should be a win either way for Signature.Trust because they're two carries low and it's 5-3. But I'm just wondering, do you see how many tracks were up? Because that is a factor.
I didn't. He died very early on though. Like he was the first or second person to die.
I think he had one track at least on the Rubik, but I'm not sure who else. It's a bit worrying. I mean, this was meant to be the period that MVP take control. They got Mech on Shadow Fiend, they got level 6 Bounty Hunter. I was saying the other hero is not that item dependent. But because of recent events, the Tiny had his blink, and because of the insane start to the game, he had the Rubik also had his blink, and so the items were just there for Signature.Trust to win the early fights. As we know, MVP Phoenix not going to shy away just because they're behind, and just like keep taking the fights head on, and now it's going to be about execution, I think. The coming 2 or 3 fights, team that executes better. I mean, MVP, I think, could still win fights if they execute better. But they're at a gold disadvantage and a key item disadvantage, for sure.
People asking in chat, this was not a mid Rubik. This was a support Rubik in an aggressive dual lane down a bottom with a Juggernaut. This was not a core Rubik at all. So Jab, yeah, he's done a great job here. Fame out. He's struggling with his items a little bit. He's got 1,000 gold saved up for Arcanes if he wants to. But he wants to go for the Blink Rush himself. Lakels charge forward, but Telekinesis is there to stop the aggression. Now the turnaround with that Ice Path catching Jab. Cooldown is decent. But I don't think it's good enough. They've not got enough damage down, and Lakels just heals up through it. Now he kills off the Rubik in the back, but the Winner's Curse is big. Onto Solar Rank Warrior. Forest will die. Surely. Through the wall damage, but MVP Phoenix are still on the hunt. They take down that healing ward, and they've actually got a couple of kills. They're still chasing them down, hunting with Duo, full HP with the Ice Path there as well. Here's another track kill coming through. Double raid, one raid Requiem with the bouncing Hurricane. Dubu's bounty gets himself a triple kill and looking for a fourth. Not gonna get the ultra. There's Fame out. Well, how about we burn back up? Tiny, have a toss. Bounty's dead, but he does give up his own life for that, and all of a sudden, this Trust have gone from dominating position, game-losing position.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, this is how swingy these fights are, especially when the enemy team is a bounty hunter. So, a few missteps and suddenly MVP looking very good. A lot of gold into that bounty hunter, by the way, who I think is buying a Glimmer Cape. Yeah, he's got a talent, the Shadow Amulet.
I hate fight recap. I bring up the fight recap, it shows like 2 kills out of the 5 that happened there, or however many it was. QO stick charges up. The rune is spawning in 3 seconds, but he's got 4F behind him, so he should be able to turn and take the rune, no problems. QO bottles up a bounty rune, and is actually 4F. Telekinesis back, QO's dead. Kel still has to be on his last, but 4F will get himself a little bit further away. Jab has stolen this, and he's chasing, hunting, looking for the mad cow. Gets the stun initially, and he's got Telekinesis in 9 seconds. But 4F turns with the back with the netherite. He's not going to get the kill. MyPro is there with the Avatos to save his teammate. My goodness. So we go from a slaughterhouse mid, where it's a 5-3 exchange, Trust favor. Then an absolute demolition mid again on the other side of the map, where MVP get like 3 or 4 tracks down. Oh god, Bounty. Okay, sneaky little devil getting a kill on Rubick. But this kill here, onto this Bounty Hunter, does this allow Trust to go into the Roche pit?
That's a good question. Do they have a medallion? They've got a healing ward that's, yeah, just time darts. No, I don't think it does. Being pinged up by MVP, but they've also got the track on the Dragonauts. I think they're safe. They're going to pressure the lane a bit, maybe steal the enemy jungle and then leave. I'm interested, I've seen Bounty Hunter Glimmer Cape before, but only in SEA. Have you seen it anywhere else? Because it's obviously something counterintuitive about, like, you're already an Invis hero, and you're already basing them to buy true sights. Now you're gonna make other people invisible. Like, obviously it does add something you can use on other people. You can also reduce the spell damage incoming. But it's something that I've seen exclusively in Southeast Asia.
I feel like I've seen it on Pile I Die. But that's a feeling thing. That's not a, I'm damn sure I've seen it on him. And I think he would be one of the only people to go for it. Because Bounty Hunter is one of his heroes and he's played it a hell of a lot, so it's statistically kind of likely that he's gonna have one or two games where he picks up something funky. But no,
I guess Glimmer Cape is especially punishing against something like Juggernauts. Juggernaut himself is not going to be carrying around Dust or Sentries, so I mean, you get some Glimmer Capes and occasionally he's just gonna like whiff his Omni Slash completely because of the positioning.
Yeah, Winter's Curse as well with Forev trapped in the enemy jungle. Call down good fame that will get taken out here eventually. With the Requiem from high ground, is there anything to stun my pro? Nothing. Ice Patch is a little bit too slow. Dubu was chasing Lakels, has Omni Slash level 2 up and running. It's like MVP not going to be able to chase anyone down here unless Abba gets
himself
in position where they're back into the wall. They get the 4-man back wall, but it doesn't do anything. It doesn't actually accomplish anything here. And they'll be able to bring him down slowly but surely with a final raise. No! Yubo doesn't throw it, and Gyro is out of back up. Hyper jump it is on this slash through them all, bouncing back onto the Gyro, who just gets taken down by the spin. And look what's stolen. Ice Path on the Rubick slows down Qo's retreat. And Jab, he's 1v1 in the SF. Hyper comes back in to help.
By the way, before he stole Ice Path, he stole track. He tracked all of them. So that's actually 3 track kills for Signature Trust.
Crazy stuff. Crazy, crazy stuff. 18 to 28. Oh my goodness, this Rubick is demolishing people. But like I was saying, he got items. It's a support that does good job with limited items, right? His skill set is decent, but he can do an amazing job if you have a player like this on it. They can get an early blink, get a couple of kills, and really set the tempo of this game, because 4F Spirit Breaker has nothing. Bounty Hunter has a Glimmer Cape Arcane, a little bit of utility there, but Gyrocopter, damage is lacking, Shadow Fiend, Mech, Yasha. Signature Trust have a ton of itemization over MVP here, and take a look at Lakels. Exactly what we were looking for. The quicker, well, Battle Fury comes at around the same time as it did in the previous game, but I feel this is a lot better because he's been fighting a lot more and actually making the best use of his skill set.
Yeah, absolutely. It's funny because in the previous game he bought the drum, which is the fighting build, but then he didn't fight that much. So here he doesn't even buy the item, but he still does the early fighting, still goes straight for the Battle Fury, and I appreciate it. I think that the big difference between the two games so far is that like breaking point lane stage ends and starts being about team fights. Previous game, when that started, Signature Trust just couldn't win a fight. They couldn't run from fight, they couldn't win a fight. This time it started, they were actually at an advantage. So they kind of slipped up a bit. MVP won 1 or 2 fights, but mostly Signature Trust have done well to guard the lead that they had coming out of the lane stage. And I think they're in a pretty neat position right now. I mean, it's not a massive lead, and it's nothing that a big team fight for MVP with a bunch of track kills couldn't change. But they are in the lead. I think they get to dictate the pace of the game for now.
Well, they want a tier 1 tower up at top, it looks like, with Aegis over on the Tiny. It should be okay to go and bring that down. He's got his Aghanims done as soon as the courier comes in to deliver that as well. MVP Phoenix, do you sack this? I'm looking at Jakiro right now, there's no Yule Scepter. And again, we come back to the key items and components of MVP's actual lineup here. Bounty Hunter is roaming around, he's 585. Okay, he's getting tracks out, but they know exactly where he is. Seen him come into this ancient area. They know he's around, and with a sentry placed by Fame Out, Ubu smoked himself. He's gonna get a stun top here, and they'll take him down slowly but surely with a curve back though. Once the 2QO's gone, Solar Wreck Warrior throws the cooldown by Lakels. He still has the Omni Slash ready. Ammo will chase him down. Omni Slash onto Gyro will bring him down with a couple of quick swipes and over in the back. Looks like the Spirit Breaker TP back to base. But two big, big kills there in that team fight as Trust the upper hand. And this all happens because MVP think they're gonna be pushing tier 1 top. We thought they were gonna be pushing tier 1 top, but they mount the defense bottom lane, and that's honestly a surprising move that MVP just didn't expect.
Yeah, Trust, I mean, if you thought from the previous game that they're shy from fighting, that's a misunderstanding. I mean, they just knew they couldn't win fights. This is a team that really likes to jump straight into fights when they're in a position to win them, and they're definitely in that position in this game. And even the Wits of Wyvern now, by the way, the least farmed hero in the game, has managed to get a Blink Dagger. Like, that was the cost the whole game for Signature Trust, that Wits of Wyvern was just spamming sentries and dust and taking that hard 5 position. But with that Blink Dagger up, it's like, there's everyone with a big contribution on Signature Trust, and I actually think that's increasingly the game sort of falling into their hands, becoming very difficult for MVP Phoenix to recover without a few mistakes from Trust.
I've just brought up the gold, the net worth and XP graph for this exact reason. As you were saying, at perfect timing, you look at it, it's dead even. Dead even for the first 20 minutes or so, and then there's that one key pivotal moment where it starts swinging down to Trust's favor, and it's like a 7,500 net worth and experience lead, but Lakels drops up a top. Good combination of spells there from MVP. Rest of Trust were actually smoked up and looking to
maybe
bait him out. They still want to go in for this. They've got Tiny with Aegis, they've got back wall. That Winter's Curse is just finding the right target because Forever has charged. Darkseer, the cooldown will land on the two big targets here as Fame out on the retreat out. Darkseer is dead. Don't know if they can fight anymore because Jab is being chased down. Tiny, do you re-engage into this? Your Aegis is going to expire in like a minute and a half. You need to do something with it. Shadow Fiend is target, and he goes shred him. Hero's gone, but the amount they lose from this, that's a 3-for-1 so far. Tiny fuels up, he's held in place. If they can wait this out, if they can wait the Aegis out, Solar Wreck Warrior caught back. Winter's Curse as well, and Mypro tries to slap. Get the damage into move with the Cold Embrace. Maybe they can do it, and they will. Mypro doesn't die. And finally, Trust, they make the most out of that team fight. It looked awful. That looked absolutely awful for them, but Mypro, he targeted correctly.
Yeah, it started really well for MVP, but I think they got a bit carried away because it started really well, and it's kind of the MVP style. It is like, people say cure is feast or famine, but the whole team really is, in the sense that like, the momentum starts rolling, and it's not a team that's likely to say, okay, fine, stop, let's go back, that's enough. And in this situation, they are actually fighting from a disadvantage. Like, sure, things start well, but if you get into such protracted fights and you've used all your things, I don't know, all of a sudden you can get into a lot of trouble. And we saw Tiny, like, burst down Shadow Fiend from close to full HP, actually, with just a combo. And that's going to be really scary. Yeah, Kyo is going to finish S&Y soon, but actually, I don't know, maybe forget about that S&Y and just go straight into the BKB if I was Kyo.
I don't even... That's a difficult thing, though, isn't it? You buy BKB just to deal with Tiny Avalanche? Like, it's Avalanche, Vacuum, and Telekinesis. Those are the things you're really afraid of. It's the lockdown. But...
Yeah, but... You can't afford to be burst down just single-handedly by the Tiny Ward.
Yes, so Mypro, Aegis is gone. He is healing up through the ward, but... My goodness. Sekiro just gets absolutely annihilated now. Mypro's up on the front, and QO is aggressive here into this surge onto Mypro. If you look forward into this aggressive play, but over on the backside is Gyro, launching the cooldown. Toss forward is Abba, but they've got the Winter's Curse. QO is dead again. No buyback available, and this Shadow Fiend is just getting taken down time and time again now. With the Gyro on the retreat, out the kill, Spirit Breaker over to the west. That's all fine and dandy, but they're going to actually look for the Bounty Hunter first. Mypro is hunting him. Blink ready, Avatar's available as well, but they want the Gyro. Slim Cape does to follow through, give that vision back on the Solar Rank Warrior, and that's going to be his demise. Maybe get the kill on the Darkseer here, but inevitably you're dead and you're losing two tier 2s.
Yeah, MVP are, I think, to some extent, doing the best they can. They're playing quite well, but they're just not strong enough. That's what I think. And especially the Winter Wyvern, being able to cold embrace people, keeps costing them. Every time they try and, like, one of the most obvious ways for MVP's lineup to try and come back into the game is to, at the start of the fight, burst someone down. But when Winter Wyvern can just cold embrace them, like, it's very difficult for an issue with Shadow Fiend's Ray to hit the raises or hit the Requiem, but that's what he tried to do there, actually, go in and go with the Quarter Brace Hero, but he got burst on himself as a result. He got Winter's Curse. So the options are actually quite limited, I think, by MVP. They don't have the most dynamic of drafts. They don't have the most dynamic of heroes. Like, Chikira does one very specific thing. Same as Spiritbreaker, same as Bounty Hunter. Yeah, they've got two big damage dealers, but their damage dealers are both actually quite squishy still.
I'm just trying to remember, in the previous game, Signature.Trust had three healing heroes. They had Juggernaut, Witch Doctor, plus one. Was it the Winter Wyvern as well? It was, right?
Yeah, it was.
So this is two games in a row where Trust have run these very, you know, quite focused, sustained lineups, where they've got multiple sources of heal. And in neither of the games have we seen AA. Was it banned in both games? Because I can't quite remember.
I don't think it was, actually.
I don't think it was either.
Yeah. I mean, MVP's approach to punishing the healing, and it is, I think it is one valid approach, is to, like, fight through it. If you get into a position where you... how do I explain this? You win a couple of fights against the lineup that has all the healers, suddenly that lineup's crippled because all those heroes do really is, you know, play sustain, but their sustain is failing. Obviously, when the dynamics change, like, yeah, well, that's gonna be Solar Rank Warrior being chased down by an entire team of heroes, and I think he has to go down.
He has no BKB, like, that's the only thing that can save him from this. It's a rough scenario. Yeah, I guess it's kind of the same situation as what you're saying with, like, armor strats and minus armor strats, is that if you have a minus armor strat, let's say you have, like, you know, Ven, Vist, Drow, whatever, with a Shadow Fiend, if you go behind and your opponents get Vlad's AC faster than you can actually build up your levels and get that momentum or the sort of critical mass point, then you fall short. You always fall short in team fights. Kind of the same with this healing. If your opponent has enough nuke damage to break through the first couple of fights through the healing, then you're always going to be very timid in actually engaging into fights, even if you can. But you're just broken. You're just broken from the get-go, really. Now, Rack's falling. 28 minutes in, Signature.Trust get charged on in, but Telekinesis once again. Jab is just on the money with his left and QO. Oh, I don't know about this. Back at the wall. Abbott caught them with the curse. Semi's gone and forever. Gonna get taken down shortly after. Two drop with Zubu and QO being forced back behind the tier 4s. My approach is linked in aggressively. Toss is an illusion. But there's, you know what? I'm in your base now. All fight.
MVP just won a chase there. This is the only mode they know. They're gonna try and win through a fight and...
Oh, jab.
I don't know, at some point I think Signature.Trust might turn around and punish them for it.
I think it's now, the tracks being traded there as Rubick and Bounty Hunter pointing their fingers at each other and saying, hey, I see ya. The tracks up here onto QO, hang on a second, what the hell happened there? Is that a four staff? QO's still gonna get hunted down as actually Avalanche Toss, 4F is dead. Mid-air, slammed into the ground, Dubu and QO. Breathing vacuum back is big! They got them both, and Jab will find the Fade Bolt back onto him. He's going to try and steal as much as he can, but it's only the invis from the bounty. Abba forces himself away. Dubu forces himself away. Yules is up for that Sekiro, and maybe he's gone a little bit too deep. Even with the Guardian Greaves, he's got one up in a second, but he's burning, he's ticking, he's going to drop. No! The Cold Embrace! Feymal gets a save onto him, and it's not going to be enough to kill Abba with the Ice Path following through. Shuriken will finally secure that kill, and up on top lane, the Gyro is pushing tier 2. But you are losing two lanes of racks here up against Signature.Trust.
Yeah, it's heavy days for MVP the Phoenix, I want to say. Essentially in the same position that they put Signature.Trust in early on in last game, where, you know, they're damned if they do, damned if they don't. It's near impossible for MVP Phoenix to win a fight, but the only reasonable way for them to come back into the game is by winning a fight. So,
you have to fight.
Options very limited.
You have to fight to win a fight, but if you fight, you're going to lose the fight. It's, yes, it's a position that I would not wish on my worst enemies for MVP Phoenix at this point in time. It's like a 20k net worth lead for Signature.Trust, as well as a 15,000 experience lead. Two lanes of racks ahead. And this tiny BKB Blink Aghanim Scepter, do you go Moonshard or do you go AC? The question
and
has
Ego
been
Moonshard.
Answered. He goes Moonshard.
Yes.
Good. And we look at the Juggernaut, honestly. Do items even matter on this guy? He's gone Battle Fury to secure the late game, but he's done so well fighting early game that 15,000 net worth is good, right? It's a good, solid amount. But for 31 minutes on a one roll carry, it's not an amazing amount. It's not a spectacular amount, especially when you're leading and you're winning a game. Trust have been fighting so much that even though their net worth look good, they're not where they should be.
This is the Hail Mary. MVP want to win this fight, so they could wipe their party quarters.
Oh, well, my bro. Oh, he's got the PKD Blink Avatar, and they're both caught in it. The curse is just over. MVP, you've got nothing left to give. SF dead for a minute. Solo rank warrior on the retreat out. Gyrocopter, it takes two slams here. My pro. Toss? No? Just waiting for it. Get Ice Pathed up. Wyvern buys back into the game for the one kill that MVP did manage to secure. And I think they've seen him. They've seen him. They've got him in a... No, they don't. No vacuum, yeah, no telekinesis, no blink, avalanche, nothing left here. Trust.
MVP are not going to come back into this game by, like, getting arts alive after a fight. You know, that's not going to be what does the trick. And, yeah, I don't know. I just want to say Rubik, sure, he had a great start, and early on kills matter a lot. So we're like, oh, he's, like, highest net worth or second highest net worth. But he's still third highest net worth in 30 minutes into the game. He's got himself an Aghanim Scepter, he's got blink, he's got 4-stuff earn, another 2k, and it's just, like... been the jab show, I think, this game. Speaking of jab.
Forev. Buddy. This Rubik has been so good up against the Spirit Breaker. So good.
Yeah, I hope Kura's watching, because that's in his interview. It's like, you know, one of the nerfs to Rubik is that he's not that good against Spirit Breaker anymore. And it is true what he said, that the charge gives you way less value. You used to be able to charge through teams and stun them all, and you can't do that anymore, but it's still really good at, like, stopping the Spirit Breaker's charge itself.
Well, Bevy, high ground defense time, buddy. But with my pro just running straight on in, nearly one hit kill Dubu there with the combination. My pro, he's got Aegis BKB. Using it up here is not going to be the ideal scenario. You can just cold embrace him, get him back up to like, oh, with the healing ward, 100% HP. I was going to say like 85, 90, but he's full health again. Ridiculous with the Earnest, well, he just blinks forward against QO. He's going to drop BKB up to my pro, and with that damage done, it looks like it's over. When his curse on the Febian, my pro just slaps people down. Forev charged in, but Solar Rack Warrior doesn't do any damage. Cold down Black Cannon is tickling. Signature Trust as they now have a Crimson Guard up on someone. Who even has it?
The Darkseer.
Darkseer has it. Okay. Toss Illusions back into the Fountain. My pro, Fountain farming. GG's called. It's all over now. 1-1 is your final score on the doors here as Signature Trust tie things up against MVP Phoenix. And it's honestly very good showing in game number two.
Yeah, that's eating successfully with all the top teams in the region recently. They haven't, like... you know, showing themselves to be contenders for the best, but they've been able to beat all the best teams, that's absolutely for sure. Where MVP Phoenix, I think, a very big win for them, because this is a team that really have looked amazing recently to me. I guess Bugattis are saved on both sides today.
Yeah, well, let's take a quick look at the bracket, the grid even, not the bracket. So Trust now, 3 games, 1 win, 1 loss, 1 draw. MVP Phoenix still second place with 7 points, but...